Hi everyone, I'm Dr. David Hood, and I run a lab here at York University, and the purpose of this set of videos is to show you what we do in the lab from a research perspective, to show you some of the techniques, the biochemical and molecular techniques that we use in exercise physiology research devoted to mitochondria. Now, you can see from the accompanying slide that we're interested in performance of humans, human exercise physiology, and what determines the performance in human beings. Research can be done on humans, but I've chosen in my career to study animal models of muscle and cell culture models of muscle for reasons that I believe allow me to dig deeper into the molecular and cellular events that occur during exercise. So that's the biased focus of the videos that you're going to see, is a focus on the use of animal models and cell culture models in exercise physiology research. So if you're going to study exercise physiology research using animal models, then you better have some good models of exercise that you can use to analyze the muscle. So there are four that I'd like to describe briefly here that we use in our lab that are quite popular around the world for studying exercise physiology in animals. The first involves running on a treadmill, and Jonathan will describe how this treadmill works and what we use it for. The second is a voluntary running wheel model, in which the animal runs on a wheel, as you've probably seen before. The third is a chronic exercise model similar to training called chronic contractile activity. And there's a video that is accompanying that will show you what exactly that is, how we do that. And the fourth is called the in situ muscle hind limb preparation that I'll describe in detail.
So here we have a couple different models of exercise that we use in the lab. In the space here we have the mouse treadmill. So this allows us to control the exercise stimulus, and we can use it for a couple different models of exercise. We can do acute bouts of exercise, so one exhaustive bout, and then we can take the tissue and look at different measures of gene expression and metabolites that change with that acute bout of exercise, or we can use it over a prolonged period of time as a training study. And again, the benefit of the treadmills is that we can control the stimulus across our animals, and we can increase the intensity as they develop throughout the training stimulus. And so over here we have our control, and we can turn the machine on, and then we can adjust the speed according to the intensity that we want to run the animals at. And so you can see here, the animal is on the treadmill, and they naturally like to run. We can increase the speed, and hopefully they keep up. And then over here we have the running wheel. And so this is another model of exercise that we can use. The benefit of the running wheel is that it's far less stressful for the animal. They're allowed to run whenever they desire. So right now it's daytime, so the animal's sleeping, but at night they get on the wheel and they run quite a lot. And so we have the wheel inside the cage and a counter that's hooked up to it. So with every revolution, we're counting the distance that the animals are running. So the benefit of the treadmill is that we can actually control the exercise dose, whereas with the wheel, it's purely voluntary. So we can't motivate the animal to get on the wheel to run. It's purely up to their motivation.
So our mouse is a volunteer today, and I'm going to do some surgery on him. His muscles will be used in the experiment to help explain muscle contractile properties, adaptations of muscle, and the role of different proteins in the muscle contraction and adaptation process. The first step in the process is to take our volunteer and put him in this anesthetic chamber right here. This chamber is connected to an isoflurane gas system, and in a very, very short time, the mouse will be asleep and he'll be anesthetized. And that piece of tubing that you see coming out of this isoflurane anesthetic machine leads here to the surgical area. And I'm going to do some surgery on the animal to expose the muscle. You can see the surgical tools that I'm going to use and the gloves that I'll use. have a mask that I'll put on in a few minutes to do the surgery and expose the muscle for the experiment. Once the animal is prepared, I'm going to move him over to this platform over here, and he'll still, of course, be anesthetized. And we're going to have the muscle attached to this set of instruments here. And the entire preparation is called the in situ hind limb muscle preparation. And it's called that because the muscle is actually in the same situation that it normally is, hence the word in situ preparation. It's still in the animal, still gets its own blood flow. The animal is just asleep and perfusing the muscle like it normally would. So that muscle will be here, and it'll be connected to this instrument called a force transducer, which transduces the mechanical signal of the muscle into an electrical one, which we can then visualize on that computer, which is down below, or a bigger screen, which is over here to the left, so that people can see the contractile activity that comes out of the muscle. To make the muscle contract, we have a stimulator here that basically varies the workload to the muscle, and I have an electrode that I'll attach to the sciatic nerve of the animal that leads to the hind limb muscle, and that'll make the muscle contract. And I can make it contract at various intensities, frequencies, to elicit different workloads. What you can see here is the in situ mouse hind limb muscle preparation. The gastric nemius is exposed here, and it's being stimulated by this electrode that is attached to the sciatic nerve, which is exposed and sitting on the electrode. The blue wire is a temperature probe that's keeping the muscle, or at least monitoring the muscle temperature, at around 37 degrees. The muscle is contracting now at 1 tetanic contraction per second. So this is a model of exercise at a pretty low intensity, and if I want to change the intensity, I can simply increase the stimulation rate, and the muscle will contract, for example, twice as fast. That's like increasing the workload on a treadmill from one grade to another grade, a higher grade, to increase the workload, obviously. So the object of this is to see how the muscle behaves in response to contractile stimuli like this, from a metabolite point of view, from a gene expression point of view, and from a performance point of view. We're looking at, we take the muscle out and we can analyze it biochemically for mRNA or for metabolites like lactate or ATP or glycogen. And we can also allow the muscle to recover and see how the recovery period takes place. And we can also take the muscle out for histochemistry, and I'll show you the muscles shortly that we'll remove from this animal that we can use to analyze fiber types. The result of that stimulation is shown here. What you can see is the muscle contracting at full force on the left-hand side. These are tetanic contractions, so the summation of individual stimuli giving us the maximum force output of that gastric nemius muscle. And you can see that because we're stimulating at 1 tetanic contraction per second, that there's a loss of force. You can see that tracing here, that's fatigue, obviously. And then when we increase the workload to 2 tetanic contractions per second, that increased workload results in even greater loss of force that you can see is coming to a steady state here. Stop the contraction, stop the stimulation at this point here to allow the muscle to recover. So what you can see in this image is the big gastric nemius muscle on the far left. The gastric nemius is a fast twitch muscle. It's comprised mainly of type 2A, 2B, and 2X fibers, and you can see it's relatively pale, meaning low mitochondrial content, low to intermediate. Beside that, to its right, is a slim fibered extensor digitorum longus muscle, the EDL, of a similar composition. This muscle is very useful for histochemistry because its long parallel fibers allow us to cut serial sections in the, for histochemical analysis. The big red organ that you see there, of course, is the heart, and you can see from its redness that it gets a lot of blood flow and it has a very high myoglobin and mitochondrial content. And that's reflected in the red color because myoglobin and mitochondria have a lot of heme, which is a red pigment, and so that makes the muscle red. And on the far right side, you can see the soleus muscle, again a slim fibered muscle that is comprised largely of slow twitch fibers, type 1 fibers, and those types of fibers of course are useful for postural maintenance, and they're used a lot, and they have a pretty high mitochondrial content. You can see that in the redness of the muscle. You ever wonder how athletes know their fiber type composition, whether they have a lot of fast twitch fibers or slow twitch fibers, or whether they're oxidative or glycolytic? Well, one of the ways we can do that is using histochemistry. Histochemistry is a technique, as you can see in the accompanying slide, in which you can do histochemical stains for fiber types, mitochondria, glycolytic enzymes, and also immunohistochemistry, where you can add an antibody and identify the amount of a specific protein in a muscle section. So Michaela is going to show you in the next video exactly how we do that histochemical staining procedure.
Okay, so now I'm just going to be explaining the process of how we actually go from the tissue extraction, so right from the animal, and then how we freeze it in order to then prepare it for sectioning for histochemistry. So what we have here is muscle that is freshly extracted from the animal. What we're then going to do is we're then going to coat it in this cryomatrix, and this is also a mold, and we're basically just going to coat the muscle thoroughly with cryomatrix, which essentially just coats the muscle and allows it to maintain its morphology once it's frozen. So then I'm just going to take these tongs, and what I'm then going to do is I'm going to dip the muscle into this canister right here, which is isopentane that is being cooled over liquid nitrogen. So we're basically just going to dip it in for around 10 to 12 seconds. It usually depends on the size of the muscle. And so it's good because now we're seeing that the cryomatrix is freezing because it's turning white. So we're just going to leave it in for a bit longer. Okay, that should be good. So I'm now just going to kind of pour out the excess isopentane. And so we find that this method using isopentane actually helps in preventing freeze fractures because it can actually get to a colder temperature than just the liquid nitrogen itself. And so now what we can do is we can either wrap the muscle in tin foil and store it at minus 80 to section later at a later date, or we can just throw it right in the cryostat and start sectioning immediately. So what I'm going to be demonstrating today is muscle sectioning for histochemical staining. And so normally with experiments, we do a lot of work looking at like protein content or anything like that. But we also look at the morphology of the muscle. And in order to look at the morphology of the muscle, so let's say fiber typing, or even looking at Cox and SDH staining, we need to section the muscle into very thin slices. And then we will stain them with different antibodies, and then we will image them on the confocal microscope. And so this is a cryostat where we essentially put the muscle in a minus 20 environment, and then we cut the muscle with a thin blade, and we usually cut it at 10 microns in order to produce a very thin slice, which we will then transfer onto a glass slide, and then that's when we will then store the sections, and then we will stain them however we want to. Now that we've gone over the embedding process, basically our end result is the muscle embedded in the cryomatrix that's mounted on the chuck, and the cryomatrix has now frozen, so it becomes a white instead of a clear. And so we basically put down this anti-roll plate so that we can basically come up with a flat, even section, and so that it kind of doesn't curl up on itself. Then basically with this rotating wheel, that basically controls this part that will then kind of put the muscle onto the blade. And so we now have a section that is flat. We're then going to take a slide that is at room temperature, and when the slide is at room temperature, the section will kind of just jump onto the slide. And so now we can see that we have the cryomatrix, and then we have a nice muscle section that's 10 microns thick on the slide. And this is basically what we will use to then treat the sections with any kind of antibody that we want to look at its morphological features, including fiber typing.
So So in order to analyze muscle biochemically using Western blotting techniques or DNA gel electrophoresis, you have to solubilize the muscle. You have to make a homogenate out of it. In other words, you have to take a solid piece of muscle and make a liquid blend out of it. So you take your piece of muscle and you put it in a tube like this, and along with some buffer, and you basically homogenize it using what we call a modified blender, a mini blender, in which you turn the instrument on and it cuts the muscle into pieces and basically in the middle of the buffer makes a homogenate out of it, so that you can go from there and measure the protein concentration of that homogenate. You can apply it to gels for electrophoresis, or you can analyze it for DNA. And the accompanying slide helps you to understand how we do that. So once you have a homogenate, then you may want to use a centrifuge to separate the homogenate into its components, its cellular components. Centrifuges, like the ones that Ashley is going to explain right here, are useful to separate the important components of the cell into their parts according to density. And the accompanying hand-drawn slide that I show you here shows you how you can separate organelles based on their density using a centrifuge.
This is our ultracentrifuge. We use this to isolate specific organelles such as mitochondria or lysosomes. And unlike our regular tabletop centrifuges, which are much smaller, this ultracentrifuge can reach speeds of up to 100,000 G compared to our tabletop, which can only reach about 25 to 30,000 G. So this uses the principle of differential centrifugation, whereby organelles of different masses will pellet or fall to the bottom of a tube at different speeds. And so as you can see inside, we have one of our rotors with the tubes, and so we can use this to spin our samples down and isolate things such as mitochondria or lysosomes or even nuclei.
One of the most popular techniques in muscle exercise physiology these days is using Western blotting technique or immunoblotting technique. And the method allows you to measure specific proteins and how they change with exercise or with training or with muscle disuse. Very powerful technique. And the accompanying slide shows you the whole overview of the technique and how it works. But Brandon, in this short video, is going to explain how we do it in this particular lab.
All right, so now we're going to talk about the Western blotting procedure or technique, and it's a commonly used technique within the lab, and it's actually to measure protein content within skeletal muscle as well as cells. And so pictured here, the first step is actually running your gel. And so the gel will actually separate the proteins based on size. So the larger proteins or the heavier proteins will be on top, whereas the lighter proteins or the smaller proteins will be at the bottom of the gel. So it'll run completely through. And as we can see here, this would be an example of the proteins running across the gel. So we're about halfway through the running process. After an hour and 45 minutes of running the gel, we are now ready to transfer the gel. So to transfer the gel, we take a nitrocellulose membrane, shown here, and we would gently place this on top of the gel, which is pictured here. So we would place it on, basically sandwich it together. Pictured here. Once it's sandwiched together between the membrane and the gel and paper, we're actually going to place it into the transfer apparatus. And so when we place it into the transfer apparatus, it's actually very specific because the current will actually push the protein or the proteins on the gel to the membrane. And so that's a very specific step. And following an hour and 30 minutes or an hour and 45 minutes, we are now ready to ponce the gel. All right, so after an hour and 45 minutes of transferring the gel, we're now ready to ponce the gel. And so ponce is essentially just a red stain, which we can see here. So this serves an important role because we can actually identify total protein content on the membrane. Basically a quality check that the transfer actually was performed properly. And so as we can see, we can identify the thicker bands, and it's also important because we can actually cut specific bands that we're interested in for various weights. After that, we are now ready to block the gel. So blocking the gel is performed with 5% milk, and it's placed on a rotating table for 1 hour, and it basically blocks the unreacted sites of the membrane. Following 1 hour, we are now ready to apply the primary antibody. So the primary antibody is protein specific. So an example I'll show in a couple of seconds is TFE3. So in that specific Western blood, we were interested in TFE3. So we'd use this TFE3 specific antibody, primary antibody. After it was put on the membrane overnight, we're now ready to apply the secondary antibody. And so the secondary antibody is specific to the primary antibody, and it's usually anti-rabbit or anti-mouse. After 1 hour of applying that, we're now ready to image our gel, so the final product. And so as we can see here, as I was mentioning, we were interested in TFE3. So we have a control lane, we have a knockout lane, control lane, and a knockout lane. And as we can see, the knockout lane, as expected, has reduced protein content. And we can identify that because a darker band would be indicative of a higher protein content. We also have GAPDH pictured here because that would serve as a protein loading control.
A very popular thing you see these days in the news media and advertising is how to identify yourself and your ancestry. You know, companies like DNA, 23andMe, and other DNA analysis companies use a technique called DNA gel electrophoresis to take a sample of your DNA and run it on a gel and identify different patterns, because everybody has a different pattern of DNA. When you take the DNA and you break it into pieces using specific enzymes, you can see different patterns according to different genotypes. And that tells you a little bit about their ancestry. We, in the lab, use DNA gel electrophoresis to identify mutant animals or different cell types that have variants in their DNA. And Ashley's going to show you how this DNA gel electrophoresis works.
All right, so this is an example of a DNA gel. So this is very similar to the Western blot, the electrophoresis, in which we can load DNA into an agarose gel and pass an electrical current through it and allow it to separate based on size. And so as you can see here, there's a current moving through the gel that allows the DNA to move through the agarose gel and separate based on its size. The agarose gel itself is stained with ethidium bromide, which allows us to visualize the different genes using a UV light. This allows us to identify genotype differences between our animals. And so as you can see in the image, you can see that there's wild type animals as well as knockout animals, and you can see the difference in the bands on the screen. So in this image, this is a portion of a DNA gel, which you can see we are probing for two different alleles of the same gene. So we're probing for a wild type and a mutated version. In order to determine whether or not an animal is a wild type or a knockout, we are looking for the presence of the wild type and the mutant allele. So you can see that the first two animals, which each animal has two lanes, these first two animals only have a wild type allele, making them wild type animals. The last two animals, again, they both take up two lanes there, have both the wild type allele as well as the mutant allele. The mutated version is a non-functional version of the protein, thus making those animals knockouts.
One of the ways to study muscles is to examine them in isolation, independent of whole body influences, grown by themselves as only muscle cells, from the tiniest myoblast to a functioning and contracting myotube. And to do that, we use two pieces of equipment that are critical: a sterile cabinet in which we can isolate the cells and put them in a media that allows them to grow. And then we take them from the sterile cabinet and put them in this incubator at 37 degrees in the right humidity, and we grow the cells, and they grow into lovely myotubes. And Ashley's going to explain how we use these myotubes to study muscle biochemistry.
Okay, welcome to cell culture. So here in this lab, we primarily use C2C12 murine skeletal muscle cells. These cells are derived from a mouse. Now C2C12s, when they're immature, or when we first see them, they are very unique. They have multiple projections, and they only contain one nucleus. In order to maintain these cells in their immature state, and just to continue to proliferate them, we supplement their media with fetal bovine serum. And this has all the factors that the cells need in order to maintain it in this immature stem cell-like state. We grow them in our incubators, which maintain the temperature at 37 degrees and at 5% CO2. We can promote the maturation of these cells into myotubes. Now, myotubes are essentially myoblasts that have fused together into a tubular structure, and these myotubes contain multiple nuclei. This is more similar to a muscle fiber that you would find in your own muscles or in an animal. The nice thing about myotubes is that when we pass an electrical current through the myotubes, we can actually promote them to contract. And this is very similar to exercise. This is what we actually call exercise in a dish. This is our in vitro model of exercise training. And so, as you can see here on this lid, we have some platinum electrodes, which allow us to pass a current through the cells, which promotes their contraction. So you can see here in the incubator, I have some cells that are differentiating, or sorry, that are stimulating at the moment. And if you look at the instrument, you can see that the current is fluctuating, indicating that there's an electrical current being passed through the cells. And in the video, you'll be able to see these myotubes actually contracting. So when our cells are not growing in their incubator and we need to handle them hands-on, we use our biosafety cabinet. Now, cells themselves need to be maintained in a sterile environment, and so the benefit of using this biosafety cabinet is then when it's not in use, we can shine this UV light, which essentially will kill all of our germs, and then we can turn it off when we're using our cells so that we know that our environment within the biosafety cabinet is sterile. We also spray everything down with 70% ethanol to ensure that anything that's going into the biosafety cabinet is sterile as well.
So you've just heard about how we differentiate muscle cells in culture from single nucleated myoblasts into elongated myotubes, and we can make them contract. If we want to see in great detail what's inside those myotubes, we use an instrument called a confocal microscope, and we stain the fibers for different organelles. And Matt is going to show you how this confocal microscope works, and shows you. He'll also show you the individual organelles within the muscle fibers. It's spectacular, is the word I can use to describe it. Just looking at individual organelles within muscle cells. Fantastic.
Okay, so this is the confocal microscope. And this microscope is unique because it allows us to measure fluorescence within samples. So what we can do is we can fix cells or fix tissue, or we could even do it in live cells and live tissue, and we can add a probe to the sample that either tags specific cellular components, such as the mitochondria, or we can tag specific proteins within a sample if we want to measure those. And basically the way it works is we have a laser that excites the fluorescent probe, and it causes that probe to emit a light of a certain color. And what we can actually visualize is that color. So if we go over here, what we can see is in this first image, it's actually a video, and it's where we've stained cells with what's called MitoDS red, which, as the name suggests, it makes the mitochondria fluoresce red. So you can see the red fluorescence, and we can actually measure this over time. So we can actually see in the video the mitochondria moving as we image them. We can also work with myotubes. So that was a myoblast. We can work with myotubes. For example, this image right here, where we stain the cell for red mitochondria, green lysosomes, and blue nuclei. And we can also work with that to get a picture of what we want within our sample. The last thing I want to show you is actually an image of a tissue, of a live muscle. And what you can see is green and like a reddish yellow color. And this is called mitochyma. So the green is healthy mitochondria, whereas the reddish yellow color are mitochondria that are actively undergoing degradation in the lysosomes through mitophagy.
because mitochondria are so important for muscle physiology and muscle adaptations to exercise, we have developed three different ways of measuring mitochondrial function in muscle. Ashley's going to show you all three of those and talk about all three of those different ways using the Clark electrode, the Ouroboros equipment, and this one here called a Seahorse to measure oxygen consumption in cells.
In our lab, we use multiple methods of measuring respiration or oxygen consumption at the mitochondrion. We can use our Clark electrode, which allows us to measure oxygen consumption with an isolated mitochondria and generates a graph similar to this one. And so with the Clark electrode, we can look at state 4 respiration or succinate or glutamate supported respiration. And we can also look at maximal respiration, which is when we supply ADP to the system. We also use the Ouroboros instrument, which allows us to measure oxygen consumption in permeabilized skeletal muscle fibers. So this would be in vivo and generates a graph similar to this. The nice thing about the Ouroboros is it actually measures oxygen consumption as well as reactive oxygen species or ROS production at the same time, because these two processes are fundamentally intertwined. We can also use the Seahorse instrument, which is primarily used for cells in culture. We can also use this for isolated mitochondria. Now, the Seahorse itself uses a variety of inhibitors and gives us a little bit more of a detailed description of the respiratory profile or the oxidative profile. And we can understand things about respiration such as ATP production, the spare capacity, proton leak, and even basal respiration.
So the purpose of these short video clips was to give you an idea of the biochemical techniques, physiological techniques that we use to study muscle, muscle adaptation, and adaptations to exercise in our high-level lab that does this research all the time. I want to thank my graduate students for participating, and I want to thank Mitchell Scheel for his expert videography. And we're all part of the Muscle Health Research Center here at York University, which is a very unique center devoted to muscle health, the biggest one in Canada. So thank you very much for watching, and I hope you enjoyed the video.